This program was first broadcast on Canterbury's community access radio station Plains FM 96.9 and was made with the assistance of New Zealand On Air.
It's time for Emergence News on Plains FM 96.9, citizen-made radio. Kia ora koutou katoa. Greetings and welcome to Emergence News, broadcast from the plains of Canterbury in the city of Christchurch, Aotearoa, New Zealand. We call ourselves Emergence News because we bring stories and reports of an emerging consciousness that heralds the birthing of a new age for humanity. Like any birthing process, it's a labour of love. It takes all your energy and focus, and sometimes you don't feel as though you can do it. From my observation, speaking as someone who's birthed five daughters, we are now entering the transition stage. This is the moment when it feels like you've lost control, when you can't go on, when the process has become so intense that you feel overwhelmed and somewhat powerless. This is the time you need support around you, telling you it's okay, you can do this, all will be well. When you bring the miracle of a new human being into the world, all the pain and hard labor are forgotten. Collectively, we're birthing a new golden age. It is proving to be hard and laborious and at times overwhelming. The result, however, will feel like a miracle as our consciousness expands to include all of us as one human family. We will become the loving beings we were created to be and demonstrate this as we share the world's resources, create justice and peace for all our family members. We were reflecting the other day how fortunate we feel that we have some knowledge and understanding about the crazy and chaotic times we're living in. This is why we share this good news story, one that gives us a sense of excitement and anticipation as we see this long labour progressing along the lines that has already been predicted by those who have insight into these times. We know we're not alone, that living in the world are a group of evolved beings we call the Masters of Wisdom. We know that Maitreya, the world teacher for this age, is also here with us. How do we know this? Well, over the years, we've been connected through the work of Benjamin Krem and Share International. We have been privy to the many signs of Maitreya's presence through witness accounts of those who have met him. Share International has reported the many signs and miracles he foretold would herald his coming. These include crosses of lights, healing wells, and Maitreya's hand appearing on a bathroom mirror. We have had access to the predictions he has made and witnessed them being fulfilled. To us, the body of evidence we have collated and shared over the years is overwhelming. Maitreya is the Lord of Love and comes for all people. Saint, sinner, believer, non-believer, whatever our creed or colour, he assures us we are all God's children and he comes as our eldest brother to help us in our hour of need. He urges us to stand with him, to love, to share, to access our people power and create the world anew. So with me in the studio today is Peter and John. Hello, guys.
Hello.
Nice to see you.
Great intro.
Yeah.
Really, really well thought out and well written.
Thank you. So what have you got today?
I've got a great story about people power and how large groups of ordinary people can make a change in their community.
Fantastic.
And it's pretty exciting because I think it is a forerunner of how we're going to change life on planet Earth.
Great. And Peter?
Yes, well, I've got one on radical love as a political weapon, and it's a completely new sort of theme, but this has actually happened in Turkey, and Turkey has been a fairly strict and repressive society for some time, and it's just amazing to see this coming out of Turkey. It's just incredible.
All right, great. We're looking forward to hearing it.
Maitreya often talks about the voice of the people as a mechanism, I guess. He talks about people power. He talks about the power of justice and freedom. Between Maitreya and Benjamin Krem, they've talked about the high levels of corruption that exist right throughout a society. And one of Maitreya's key observations, which has come to fruition recently, is that the youth as the bringer of the new order.
Mm-hmm.
So as I was going through the latest Share International magazine, I came across two articles that talk about what's been happening in Puerto Rico. And we don't get a lot of news from Puerto Rico. And Puerto Rico is an interesting place. It's a dependency of the US. So it's not a US state, but it's under the protection and well-being of the United States of America.
Mm-hmm.
And back in 2017, it was really hit with a hurricane. And the federal government of the US has been widely criticized for the lack of care and attention that they then poured into Puerto Rico. So it's a place that's really suffered, but it's a place that's used to, can we say, a first world or a Western style of life,
mm-hmm.
and that this hurricane really changed that.
Mm-hmm.
So they've gone back to their grassroots, and I've got two articles, and the first one is from Al Jazeera, so it's a news article. The second one's written by someone who was in Puerto Rico at this time, and it's about July 2019, and it's written by Anna Cruz, who is a Share International co-worker who lives in San Juan, Puerto Rico. And it's an eyewitness account of a 1 million person protest in the capital city of San Juan. 22nd July 2019, Anna Cruz writes, "The press looked for the people who organized this march, but no one in particular was found. It was called the March of the People of Puerto Rico. The protest was attended by people of all ages, from young to old, as well as people with various disabilities. It should be noted that the common feeling was one of joy and jubilation. The atmosphere was one of respect, cordiality, and brotherhood. We were singing, dancing, clapping, all waving our Puerto Rican flags with the pride of our Puerto Rican commonality. Among the many slogans were, 'We are more and we are not afraid,' and 'They took away so much, they even took away our fear.' The energy was overwhelming. We were a united and cheerful people, united with the joy of wanting a better future, wanting justice, wanting peace. It was wonderful to see people's creativity and much more that was shared. We shared food and water with strangers. Also, while we were marching, there was free water and food available to everyone without knowing who donated them. We even shared shade under a tree and an umbrella with a stranger. There was not a single incident of aggression. Around noon, when the sun was warm, it began raining heavily, which continued for 3 hours. This caused people to give thanks for the rain. People started dancing and jumping over rain puddles, hugging and crying. As adults, they played in the puddles like children. People shared coats with others who were cold in the rain. In that moment, the collective realization was that the heavy rains were a thank you for our awakening, our sharing, and our union with family members killed by Hurricane Maria. We held hands, prayed, and gave thanks. We spent hours in that consciousness. No matter the distance we walked, we didn't feel tired. We were certain as a people that we were going to achieve our demand, the resignation of the governor. People said, 'We are your employer and we are saying goodbye.' And the people woke up. During the march, people commented that this is something organic, suggesting that the order, peace, creativity and sharing that took place on the march was bigger than us. It was a march of no one, but at the same time of all." I think that's really poetic language that she was able to experience clearly. The very values that Maitreya has been talking about that are our new age principles.
And this is very much around the whole of the protest movements. I mean, it's not happening in Hong Kong, unfortunately,
mm-hmm.
but every, you know, Extinction Rebellion is very much about, you know, find the joy, the creativity, let's sing songs together, let's celebrate being together. You know, that sort of feeling that we are all in this together and it's something to be joyful about rather than actually, you know, even though you're fighting against, you know, a system.
It's a process of a million people.
Yeah, it's fantastic,
isn't it? It's just amazing. Anyway, let's go back to Algeria.
Yeah.
In Algeria, and I'm trying for my BBC voice here, Puerto Ricans took to the streets in historic numbers for nearly 2 weeks in July 2019. 2 weeks. They demanded the resignation of the island's governor, because of corruption and mismanagement of funds, as well as leaked text messages in which he and members of his inner circle denigrated women, gay people, and the victims of Hurricane Maria, which struck the island in 2017. After Governor Ricardo Rosello announced his resignation, Puerto Ricans across the island celebrated in the streets. Political uncertainty followed as to who would succeed him. I guess you've got to think about that, don't you? Let's top the head off and what's left. Anyway, several top government officials, including the Secretary of State, the next in line for governor, resigned also due to the text scandal. Two other members of the cabinet had recently been arrested for corruption. So there's kind of no one left in the big house, really. And another potential successor's appointment was deemed unconstitutional by the island Supreme Court. The protests in Puerto Rico were historic for a number of reasons. An estimated 1 million people took part. That's one third of the island's total population, which is absolutely amazing. Mm. The popular movement spanned the political spectrum, encompassed all age groups, and was without formal leadership. Rosello's resignation was the first time that a governor of Puerto Rico had ever been pushed out of office without an election. We are demanding a real and radical change in this country in the way that politics are done, one of the protesters told Al Jazeera. We didn't demand the resignation of a corrupt government to have another equally corrupted one. Mm. We are demanding a real alternative. This is really a Puerto Rican people's revolution. This is not going to stop until the government is cleaned up. And so that is a wonderful example for me around some of those values that we hear from Maitreya, but also that people power.
Mm-hmm.
People waking up and going, you know what? This is not fair.
Mm-hmm.
None of us are getting what we want except oligarchy.
Yeah. And it's very much Aquarian too, isn't it? The group deciding what to do rather than one person or, you know, a government. Is that, you know, they need perhaps a smaller group that actually makes a few decisions and then and ask the people, is this the way we want to go?
Yeah.
The other thing that comes through here is there's no leadership.
Mm. Yeah.
And that's one of Cream's principles about new age groups. There is no leader.
Yeah. Yes.
People have a common goal and work towards it as best they can.
Yeah. Yes. And so everyone understands the goal.
Yes.
And so they're all working towards that goal.
Mm. Yeah. There's no whip cracking and carrots.
So watch this space, eh?
Very good stuff.
Yeah. Thank you, John.
This is the Emergence News on Plains FM. For more information, go to shareinternational.org. Right. This article actually is from Share International as well, and it's entitled Radical Love as a Political Weapon. And I thought that's a great way of looking at something new because the politics, of course, have been anything but love. They've been, you know, very divisive, and I hate the opposition there, and let's tear them down, and, you know, just completely destructive thinking process. And how to win an election in this time of polarization and hate. A book about radical love cracked the code for Turkey's oldest political party this summer, the Republican People's Party. When Ekrem Imamoglu started the election campaign to become the city mayor of Istanbul this summer, he told his party colleagues, "When you get home this evening, I ask you to find a neighbor who does not think like you do, or someone from another political party. Just give them a hug." Isn't that amazing? Hey?
Did Peter go to Woodstock back in the day? Were you in Woodstock, Peter?
No. Never been there, but I was alive then. I confess. The election co-workers were perhaps surprised because this is an entirely new note from Turkey's biggest opposition party, the Secular Party, established by the father of the nation, Ataturk. Everyone knows about him, I think, had for years seen as an elitist and patronizing towards others. But now the city's major candidate wanted to reach out also to choose the party colleagues habitually called unenlightened idiots. You know, I mean, this is the sort of thing that happens. It happens here in New Zealand as well. Yes, you know, it's just, I mean, Muldoon sort of had particularly good words that brought all that sort of thing together.
The acrimony in Parliament's just awful.
But absolutely no help or no way of resolving any situation. Mm. So he wanted to reach those on the other side of the political divide, conservatives and religious people who felt deserted and overlooked by authorities. The party's new weapon was love, radical love. Radical love means to embrace those you do not know, those who provoke you, and those you strongly disagree with. Radical love is not easy. It is maybe the most difficult job of all. In this time, in the World Wide Web, we find like-minded people on the internet, and many only listen to those who already agree with.
Mm.
And we're all guilty of that.
We are, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, you two are the only people I speak to.
I disagree with everybody else.
Yeah. Others become the others. For example, those who have different religious faith, or in the worst case, those who threaten us. Some are being radicalized on the internet, others just feel like left out and become frustrated. The internet makes us more lonely, the strategist wrote. Now we spend all our time on the mobiles day and night. People have stopped talking to each other.
Mm-hmm.
Even when we are together in cafes and on the bus, we isolate ourselves and become more depressed and start seeing others as strangers and threatening. Therefore, we need to turn off our mobiles and open our hearts to each other and start to talk together again. Well, it's sort of an amazing sort of a revelation, isn't it? No, don't let us talk about Erdogan. They should say when meeting people, let us rather talk about how you can get a new playground in the neighbourhood. Mm-hmm. In other words, don't engage with the opposition, the radical opposition, to say, what do you need in your neck of the woods sort of thing.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
And this is a great, you know, he says, don't talk condescendingly about other politicians. Don't blame other political parties, because we can all make mistakes. Never wag your finger when you talk with voters, or you will seem like you are lecturing them.
Mm-hmm.
And this is so often happens, doesn't it? This type of behavior. When your opponent attacks you, do not answer back. Now, you see, Jacinda does this. She avoids answering back and attacking the opposition party, you know.
Yeah.
She says what she needs to keep on the subject.
That's right, yes.
Keep talk about what we're going to do.
Don't get distracted.
Yeah, and that's probably one of the first people that we've seen in New Zealand politics that actually do that sort of thing, from my memory.
Mm.
You know, it's quite radical.
Mm-hmm.
The message of the campaign was hope. The strategy was smiles. If we smile, others will too. But remember, the smile must be genuine, was the mantra. For the journalists too, it was entirely new, because they were being embraced by the campaign. We have shown that walls can be torn down by love, said the strategist after the election. The radical love, the love towards those that did not know, towards those who had already disagreed with, was returned in the magical election. So he won this mayoralty, and I don't know how the premier, how do you pronounce his name? Erdogan.
Erdogan?
Mm-hmm. Erdogan.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how he's obviously the premier of Turkey, but he's lost the mayoralty,
right,
from my understanding. So
yeah.
I don't know if that puts him in, you know, some sort of conflict there in Constantinople.
But it does show, doesn't it, that the shift, you know, because he's very hard line, isn't he?
Yes,
you
know, very much so, yes.
Yeah,
so lock up all the opponents. I mean, that's what he did with that so-called attempted coup, which he
claimed on the USA, and so he locked up thousands of people, you know, from military to political figures and all that sort of thing. So very interesting to see how it all works out in Turkey, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, yes, it's surprising, as I say, we're such a sort of a hardline country, you know, to see that sort of coming through, that it's, you know, here in New Zealand, I'd almost expect it because it's sort of we're that way, but it's really amazing to hear that.
Yes, it is. I'm just sort of overwhelmed with that story. I think, well, it is good news, and it's just what we need more of.
And definitely Maitreya's influence.
It's almost a Pollyanna moment, isn't it?
It is. Definitely, yes.
Okay.
So let's have a message from the master. This is Step by Step from 2007. From time to time, we, your elder brothers, attempt to engage humanity in an understanding of the evolutionary process in which we are immersed, knowingly or not. To this end, we convey to disciples, in whole or in part, that teaching which we adjudge to be of value at that particular time, in broadening the minds of men and acquainting them with the knowledge which will lighten their journey. From now on, while this method of teaching will continue, Maitreya and his group will involve themselves more and more directly with the general public. This humanity will see more clearly and appreciate more completely the connection between the teaching, more or less esoteric in nature, of the evolutionary process and the circumstances of their lives from moment to moment. A deeper understanding of the meaning and purpose of their lives and of the great laws which govern them will in this way be established. A great step forward by humanity as a whole can thus be expected. For disciples and initiates, the teaching will go forward in the usual way, during the hours of sleep, and that conveyed and published through certain disciples. With this exception, since the masters will work openly, more and more of the teaching will come directly from them. This, of course, will speed the process of learning and shorten the journey for disciples to a significant degree. Furthermore, the presence of the masters will help to obliterate the gulf which now exists between the disciples and the world of ordinary men. More or less all, on one level or another, will be engaged in a conscious journey of discovery and growing awareness of the magnitude of life. Thus will it be. So far, a blueprint only exists for this considerable shift in emphasis of the teaching methods used by us, but gradually this blueprint will change into a living form from which all will benefit and grow. Maitreya will show men that every step they take to remake their world and to establish right human relationships is a forward step on their journey to perfection, that the inner step for the disciple must be matched by the outer step of the man not yet engaged in the initiatory process, that all is an interrelated and integrated whole. Step by step, man makes his path at his own pace. Step by step, man moves from ignorance to knowledge, from injustice to justice, from slavery to freedom. In all such endeavours, there will be times when progress seems slow and unlikely, but man will grow in confidence and trust and learn the method of step by step. His innate divinity, lost now in materialism and commercialism, will blossom anew under the teaching of Maitreya and his group. Man will come to know himself as the creative source of all his needs.
All this information can be found on the Share International website, www.share-international.org. Scorpio Books in Christchurch carries the magazine and some books. And also don't forget the podcasts, which are available on the Plains FM website.
We welcome your comments, questions and feedback. Please contact us at emergencenews@gmail.com.
The opportunity to join our transmission is available Monday and Wednesday evenings and Thursday mornings, which gives us the possibility to do a service meditation in conjunction with Masters.